Yeah, today I want to talk to you about the anatomy of a guinea fowl puffer. At least I try. Yeah, no, shit, that's the wrong picture. Come on. That's better. Yeah, actually it's about this guy here on the screen. It's a Puffy, the mascot of OpenBSD, and this is the operating system I'm talking about, OpenBSD. It's one of the big of the big open source operating systems that are around. It's not only Linux. And OpenBSD was founded in 1995, when the project founder Theo de Raad has left NetBSD due to personal reasons. And it is an open operating system with a strong focus on security. So also, it's one of the first operating systems that have an anonymous CVS repository or an anonymous access to the version control, which was new at that time. So at that time, open source development was you had some developers that were coding something, and then they make a regular release once every few months, and that led to some doubled work. So at some point, people started implementing new stuff and asked, can you put it in? And then it turns out that someone else, completely unrelated, did the same work. So the idea was to make the development process more open, so you can see what other people are working on, and so you have you can better make your things. So what is OpenBSD? Obviously not. It's not one of the other operating systems around. It's not a free BSD, so there are several BSD like operating systems around, and the thing is, all these BSD like operating systems do have their own kernel, which is a difference to Linux. With Linux, there is the Linux kernel, and there are several projects putting all the user land together, so you have a working operating system. With BSD, you usually have a project that develops the operating system and the kernel, and there are few kernels out there. There are some kernels. FreeBSD is the most common used one. Then there's NetBSD and also Dragonfly, just to name a few. Also OpenBSD is not a coffee machine, so you have to bring your own coffee machine. As all OpenBSDs, as all BSDs, OpenBSD comes with a base system, which brings the kernel and some basic user land. In the OpenBSD case, this is, for example, corn shell, CP, all the tools you need to know. You need to set up the network, system init, and also a mail server and an HTTP server. This is also also in the base ports, and all the extra applications are integrated with a separate so-called ports tree, which is a big software repository that contains all the build instructions you need to create packages or install the software. In the OpenBSD case, there's always a package created and then the package is installed on the system. So you have basically two repositories if you want to start developing with that thing. It's the basic system repository and it's the ports tree. You may notice that it's still a CVS repository. This is because the central source of truth is still CVS with OpenBSD. If you want to, you can read the arguments there. But there is a JIT version available of the ports tree. So if you like developing in JIT or having a look on the ports tree in JIT, it's no big deal. Just fetch the JIT version, and yeah, you are good to go. One thing is also the license. All BSD systems come with a thing called BSD license, and the main restriction of the BSD license is that the license text has to be copied in every modified file. So this isn't actually very much. You don't have to release the new file open source. You can do a closed source. You can bundle it with commercial applications and so on. This is a bit in contrast to GPL, which enforces that every modified version of the source code has to be licensed under GPL. And therefore, it has to be published under GPL. And those licenses are around. We have about 200 open source licenses. So this is the main difference between those licensing schemes. Both has its good and its bad sides. The BSD license text is very easy to understand. On the downside, what Minix in the example of Minix, it could mean that a big CPU manufacturer is bundling your operating system within each CPU as a closed source product. That can happen with a BSD license, and I think it's the project decided to use that. So OpenBSD itself has a strong focus on security. More precisely, they want to create a base system that is running as securely as possible by default. And that also means that some parts of the software are written especially for the operating system. Partly it's because the software they want to use doesn't exist, or the solutions that exist do not fit in the development philosophy of OpenBSD, or partly it is also the license that doesn't fit, not entirely. If you have a good product, then it's added even if it's running under GPL, or if it's a good product under an open source license, it can be added to OpenBSD, but to the OpenBSD main system. Every software has that license. For example, years ago in 1997, I haven't looked that up again. OpenSSH was developed, and this is a side project of OpenBSD. So our SSH implementation that we are currently using is basically OpenBSD. And they needed to do that because the SSH2 implementation that was available at the time wasn't open source. It couldn't be bundled freely with other software, so it has some licensing issues. It couldn't even bundle it with Linux distributions, and so they had to do something. And OpenBSD went out, and they created OpenSSH, which also has some extra features, and it could run in place what wasn't the case for the SSH2 daemon. More recent development is OpenSMTPD, which is a complete re-implementation of a mail server. Mostly because the postfix configuration was too complex, and other mail servers were too complex, so they developed a new mail server from the ground, which is very easy to configure, and it runs very, very good. Then there is SpamD, which is a gray list anti-spam filter, which came up a few years ago. Then TMUX is, as far as I know, developed within the OpenBSD base system. Same is for Duo S, which exchanges sudo for the command line newbies. Sudo is a command that you are using to execute a command as root. If you are not root, you can do sudo some command and it executes as root, and it has a list in the back telling which commands are actually allowed to the user. And Duo S simplifies that list building a bit with a much easier to understand syntax, and is also a re-implementation. Then there is Signify, which is a signature tool which is used to sign the software packages from OpenBSD, and more basically it can put a signature on any file you want, and has is easy to use, and so on. Also a more recent development is the VMD hypervisor, which enables you to run virtual machines on top of OpenBSD. It's a very simple kept software, so you can do a good code review, but it works stable and it's easy to configure. Also, an HTTP server is in the base system. It's called HTTPD, lightweight HTTP server. What else do we have in OpenBSD? We have a kernel randomization. Kernel randomization means that on every boot, the system is relinking the kernel and its libraries. So once you reboot, you have a freshly built kernel, basically. Or at least you have the entry points of some functions on at different addresses. So you reboot, and all the exploits you have written before are not working anymore. Hopefully. I'm sure there are ways around, but it makes things harder. That's the idea. Also, there's a memory protection which integrates several technologies to protect the operating systems from attacks such as buffer overflows or integer overflows. And then there is a hard focus on cryptography and randomization. So OpenBSD does its best to encrypt everything. That's also why they have developed OpenSSH to go for the more restrictive secure shell. If you want to run graphical user environments, that's also possible, and it's also highly recommended with OpenBSD, especially if you start developing OpenBSD. It's recommended that you run your daily driver with OpenBSD too. As you may have noticed, I'm not doing it mainly because I need Bluetooth on the laptop. But I'm considering it strongly to have at least one open one daily driver that runs OpenBSD. OpenBSD has a highly modified version of the X11 GUI. It's called Xenocara, and those parts are modified in a way that they run as an unprivileged user. So if you start X11, it always runs as an underscore X11 user and not as root as some implementations. Unfortunately, we are still waiting for alternatives like Wayland, and I think this will If we find developers, then this will be a good thing. Privilege separation. OpenBSD does privilege separation mainly with two functions, pledge and unveil. This sounds a bit weird when you come from other systems that have mandatory access control lists and big frameworks, but most of the software on OpenBSD is basically open source. So what the maintainers do is they put in those pledge and unveil functions within the software package during their packaging work. And then the software runs and only has access to the system parts that it should have access to. OpenBSD is using chroot very frequently. This is still coming with other operating systems, but it's very frequently with OpenBSD that programs just do a chroot and run with the change rooted directory. It does not have jails or container as we may have seen with other operating systems. Now VMM and VMD is coming, and that allows to start a hypervised VM on one CPU core at the moment. Multi-CPU is in the work. That's definitely coming, and it's definitely getting better. If I have the need to put more than one service in one user space, then it's definitely an idea to look at OpenBSD, because that's the thing they have done very, very well. If you need to run an SMTPD and a Dovecot IMAP server on the same system, that's done perfectly nice. Most the most tricky part if you get started is to set up a VM that runs OpenBSD. This actually took me a few weeks to figure out. Mainly because everyone says, oh, it's not a problem, and I had only problems. So basically you start up with selecting an operating system in, I'm using Virt Manager and Libvirt because that's the thing that comes with Linux. And you can select OpenBSD 6.4. It's always one version back for some reason. And it's not working. So the next thing is, if you want to have a graphical user environment and play around with Xenocara X and so on, and you don't have dedicated hardware, which you might have if you just try out the operating system, then you should run with an UEFI BIOS virtual machine, which isn't the default. The default is still BIOS for all the virtualizations I know. So you have to install a package called OVMF, and then you can select the UEFI firmware OVMF. Then you need VirtIO graphics, not GLX graphics, for some reason. I still haven't figured out how to make it with GLX. But yeah, VirtIO is working fine. Then the thing with the installer, some people are complaining about the installer, that the installer isn't working or crappy or something. But the actual problem is there. We have two files there. We have an install.fs and an install.iso. Install.iso is made for a CD-ROM, so install.iso can install from a CD drive using BIOS. And the install.fs can install from a USB stick using UEFI. So you have to throw out the CD ISO in the front and put in a USB stick and run the install.fs. The next thing, for some reason, Virt Manager still isn't able to add the Eevee Touch Tablet driver on BSD systems. Every BSD template doesn't have that driver. If you don't have that driver, you have a mouse pointer that is somewhere on the screen, but not where your actual mouse is. Nasty if you want to run graphical user environments. And then you can press escape on boot, go in the UEFI BIOS, and set a preferred resolution. And that's the resolution that your graphical user environment takes after you install it. The rest of the installer is very simple. So if you install it, you can configure the whole system that it's starts a graphical user environment, and as you can see, this is the output of the installer. It's basically a text adventure. So you fire that thing up. You get a console and you type in what you need. So you type in, oh, I have a network interface and I want to configure it with DHCP. In most of the cases, you can just press enter and you get a system. So it's simple software and it does the job. That's the idea. This is the auto-partitioning scheme. In the partition setup, you will notice many more partitions than you may have seen on Linux based operating systems. This is also the case to have a stable system to so it splits up the partition where you install your applications, the partition where your home directory is located, and so on. It has some automatic partition schemes, and for the beginning, if you don't mind, you can just automatically partition the whole disk, and that's fine. Yeah, and then my presentation is almost finished, and we go to questions and answers. I have made one project in OpenBSD so far, which is an inbound mail server, which is scalable, and it spreads over 6 OpenBSD machines at the moment, with a growing tendency, probably, but I think we will scale up earliest in 1 or 2 years, if we are lucky. But yeah, at the moment it's 6 BSD machines that have dedicated features like processing inbound mail, pre-filtering with SpamD, and then filtering with Spam Assassin, and then distribute all the mails to customers' IMAP servers. So that's my access with OpenBSD. It worked very, very smoothly, and the reason to use OpenBSD was partly because it has SpamD, which is an interesting idea to slow down mail delivery from unknown IP addresses, and to eat up delivery time and CPU time on the spammer system. Interesting thing. Yeah. Also, there is obviously no systemd, because systemd is a Linux-only implementation of a sys init, but OpenBSD doesn't have init 5 as well. It has a thing called rcctl or rcinit, which they inherited from the original BSD machines and the original BSD operation system. One thing I find nice in that system is the system insecurity report, which is a big shell script that runs by default once a day. And it sends out an email with everything that has changed on the system. Which is okay if you do something on the system, then you can see what have I done. Okay, that's good. If you don't do anything on the system and the system changes, then it's most probably that something is wrong, and you have to investigate. This is a very interesting security feature, and it's built in by default. You don't have to install an extra package. Also, OpenBSD has a PF firewall, and interestingly, I haven't tried it yet, but that firewall is able to do NAT64 as far as I have read. So you can do a network address translation from an IPv6 space to an IPv4 space. And that's a thing that is especially useful if you have IPv6 only clients. Also, PF is nice to configure. It has a central config file, the workflow, how it's it is processed is a bit weird at the beginning because it processes the other way around IP tables does. So with IP tables you allow everything you need and then you block everything else, and with PF you block everything and then you allow everything you need. VMD is a thing. Package add is the package manager. Interestingly, there's also package check, which checks the system integrity of every package installed, which is also very helpful to see if something is wrong on the system. Corn shell. With corn shell, we are back with the licenses in the first place. So corn shell is a shell that is developed under BSD license, and this is the most advanced shell so far that is that is under a non-GPL license. So it is therefore the default shell with OpenBSD, and so far it can do everything Bash does. It pledge and unreal and do as I have on the list. So far, I would go to the questions and answer round, and with a bit of luck, I can also show you a virtual machine, but I have to reconfigure the laptop GUI one more time to do that. If you want to investigate something, and I can also show you a virtual machine later on. Questions? Anyone? Did I completely mess up? No. So far, the project discussed it. This is my my knowledge. The project discussed it, and they decided that it's too complex for the team to implement. It can happen that your network hardware or that your hardware in particular isn't working. You have to think with Linux. It's easy. You have a huge user base. You have a huge developer base, so it's relatively easy to get hardware in Linux running. With BSD, you have the biggest user base for FreeBSD, and maybe 10 or 15% of the BSD users are actually using OpenBSD. There is no accurate number because no one counted at some point, but you have a very small user base for that. And this also means this also means that the hardware support is is not as accurate as good as widespread. If it runs, it runs. Actually, I'm using it with my mail inbound system, because the OpenSMTPD, if I run that on Linux, for example, I always get older versions. Also, the spam D that I'm using to cut off the inbound email is developed particularly for PF firewall and on OpenBSD. So it's very hard to port that from OpenBSD to another system. It's easier just to fire up an OpenBSD system. and do the mail inbounds there. So that's what I did with my mail inbounds. It was a real world project that I did. And I'm still thinking about what can I do more with that. At the moment, we have in my company, we have a setup where we give the customers a VPN access and some websites on an internal network on our cloud. And the biggest thing there is that we have one virtual machine that combines a lot of services. It combines basically DHCP server. It combines the DNS server for the customer. It has the WireGuard connection. It has an Apache web server. And if one of these services break, then we have a problem. I mean, those services are running fairly stable, but with OpenBSD, I can do that task even more secure, because the privilege separation within the OS is basically better. So I have a good chance if I put OpenBSD in front there that this system really is secure. Yeah, definitely. It's definitely security. If you want an operating system that just does the task, then it's definitely worth a look. And it also provides lots of software in the ports tree. So you will be surprised how many software you find there. They have a full GNOME, they have a full Roundcube mail, they have a full RSpamd spam assessing implementation, basically all you need. You can do all of that with OpenBSD, if you like. So there are definitely real-world examples. And the OpenBSD development team is also using OpenBSD. Basically, this is a smaller fight between the FreeBSD and OpenBSD, because there's a picture out there on a FreeBSD con with a room full of Mac laptops and that's so far. More questions? I'm still bloody beginner with OpenBSD. Obviously, I started it half a year ago. And I've just done my first project with it. Thank you.